have fought really against to get to this spot.
They're both really strong players. I don't think this game is anywhere near over.
We are ready to get this match underway.
Good afternoon from TempleCon 2015. We are back with the beginning of the first gauntlet round of the Iron Gauntlet War Machine and Hordes World Championship Qualifier here at the show. I'm Michael Plummer, Convention Coordinator for Privateer Press.
And I'm Ed Burrell, Privateer Press's Creative Director.
And for those of you who didn't see the beginning, we have a very exciting game coming up here. We've got Rickard Nielsen all the way from Sweden. He'll be playing Rask.
And we've got Josh Drennan from Reston, Virginia, and he's going to play Dominar Rasheth with his Scorn Force.
So why don't we go on ahead and let these guys know what that Scorn list looks like.
Well, today we've got Rasheth, and he did change it up a bit from his original Rasheth list, although he's got a lot of Titans there, which is great with Rasheth. We've got the Sentry and a Gladiator, a pair of Bronzebacks, a Basilisk Drake, and he chose the Despoiler, which was a pretty interesting choice, but I do think the Arcane Suppression is going to be super handy. We've got an Agonizer, a Paingiver Taskmaster, and a Void Spirit, and I expect we may be seeing more of those Void Spirits with the Despoiler in there.
Absolutely.
Orin Midwinter is obviously a good choice, and he can hopefully help clear out some of those Bogtrog Swamp Shamblers. He upped his unit of Pain Givers to a full unit. And then we've got a Gatorman Posse who's with that Taskmaster. And then the Cataphract Incendiary, which is also going to help clear out those gribbly little shamblers.
For sure. So on the minion side, Rickard has taken Rask, of course. And his battle group is a Blackhide Wrestler, a Swamp Horror, and an Ironback Spitter. I'm afraid that Ironback Spitter isn't going to do a whole lot against everything you just mentioned. That's a lot of meat in that list.
It definitely is.
He also went ahead and took as a solo. He took Wrong Eye and Snapjaw. And on Wrong Eye, he's got a Bull Snapper. So that means that he's going to have access to Spiny Growth on both Wrong Eye. Only on Wrong Eye. So he'll be able to cast it on Snapjaw on himself and anything that's within 6 inches of him, which is going to free up some fury for Rask, which is great because that's something he's going to want to do. He's got a single Gatorman Witch Doctor, which is going to be able to give Zombify, which gives Undead and Tough to a single unit every turn, which with the stockpile that he has taken as his objective might give some interesting interactions because of the lash rule within 4 inches. Things can't be knocked down, and then at the beginning of the maintenance phase, everything's going to stand up. He took Victor Pendrake, which surprised me, but you know, now that I think about it, that beast lore is going to make it easier for him to hit the enemy beasts, which there are a lot of. And he might be able to take out a couple key solos with that lucky bow. He took 3 full units of Gatorman Posse. Not a surprise at all. Those guys hit real hard, especially with Fury. And then 2 units of Gatorman Boker and Bogtrog Swamp Shamblers. So he's got a lot of bodies on the table. And today's scenario is going to be Destruction. So for those of you watching at home that don't know Destruction, we've got 2 objectives on the table. If you destroy or remove from play the enemy objective, which can be done once per game, you earn 1 control point. And there is a 12-inch by 6-inch zone in the center of the table. Controlling that zone gives you a single control point, while dominating will give you 2. And the victory condition for Destruction is 5 control points needed for a scenario of victory, or a Warcaster or Warlock assassination, of course.
That's going to make the center of this table real ugly. And it looks like our players have started deployment. Josh is currently deploying his Scorn Force. And what I didn't talk about for Josh was that he chose the Arcane Wonder Steamroller objective. So he's going to have the Wondrous Power that's going to be able to empower his spells. So when he's within 4 inches of it, he's going to be able to upkeep spells for free. Cast and upkeep spell for free, sorry. And reduce the cost of other spells by 1. He's also going to get the Plasma Nimbus, so that anything that attacks it is going to take a shot back for PAL 10 damage.
That'll be great against those Shamblers if he's trying to use those, for sure. Looking at this deployment here that's happening, I am surprised by the amount of frontage that he's got with that list. I mean, the number of beasts he have, I wasn't expecting him to be able to cover so much of the table, but you forget how big those medium bases are
that's
with
right.
The Caterman and the Incendiary.
And it looks like Rickard is getting set up.
Yep. So he's got Rask front and center. That's kind of what I would expect. And I think he's going to put those Gatorman kind of a nice wide frontage so he can cover a lot of the table, take control of that zone, get those Shamblers in there, and really try and control the table early on. Because one advantage that Rickard's going to have here is he has a lot more bodies on the table than Josh does.
He absolutely does. And it's going to be interesting to see where he puts those two units of Shamblers. It is two units this time,
right?
He does have
2 units of those Shamblers. And, I mean, you know, you look at this and you see all those heavies and you think he's going to be able to trample over a lot of those Shamblers. But with that many bodies on the table, he's going to have a hard time finding space for a base. So
that's absolutely right. And with those with the rest being medium-based troops in there, if anywhere that they're interspersed, he's going to also set up block lanes for any kind of trample attack. He's really going to have to try to mow through those Shamblers.
Yeah, he's going to have to do it the hard way. But, you know, the nice advantage that Josh is going to have is like, all those beasts are really high arm. And, you know, Gators traditionally have a little bit of trouble breaking that army. Luckily, he's playing Rask, so he's got Fury, and that's going to help a little bit. So he can bring up those Gatorman posses up to POW 16s, which is going to do a lot of hurt. And he can cycle that onto 2 units. The beasts are going to do some work. But I don't know, man. Those Titans have a lot of hit points. It's going to be an uphill battle, I think, for Rask, but I don't think it's unwinnable by any means.
Oh, not at all. I think that there's a lot to be done with Rasheth. It's going to be interesting. Again, against all those masses of undead hordes, we've got things like Breath of Corruption that he's going to get out there. We've got Bloodmark, which I think he'll use more just for the armor reduction than for the transfer, especially if he can stay in back with that big wall of Titan flesh in front of him.
Looking at Rask's spell list, he's got Fury, which is going to help with those damage rolls, like I was talking about before. He's got Abomination, which is going to help him a little bit because Scorn is surprisingly mobile despite their low speeds. The Gladiator is going to give him access to Pathfinder. The Gatorman can march, so they're going to have Pathfinder. So he's going to be able to keep a key model safe with Abomination against charges, things like that. He has Boundless Charge, which gives himself a little bit more mobility. And normally, you know, Inhospitable Ground is going to do a lot of work for Rask, but between March on the Gatorman and the ability to rush his beast, I think it's going to slow that down a little bit. But they're about to start playing round one, so let's see what happens here. Looks like Josh is going first.
So Gators are going to get the March Prayer from the Taskmaster. Is that really a prayer? And he's going to advance those Gators right through that forest, thanks to March.
So that March ability actually comes off the leader of the Gatorman unit, yes, not off of the Taskmaster.
Right.
Looks like they're all within command, so we're good there.
Command, so they did run up there. Obviously, they're not that fast. And then it looks like the Taskmaster follows up.
And that Taskmaster just gave the Gatorman Posse tough.
Yes, it did. Temper Flesh. Void Spirit runs up amongst the Gators in the forest. And he is rushing with the rushing the Gladiator on a bronze back. And a slam declared so that Gladiator can move up 7 inches. Looks like the slam has clearly not reached its target.
So that will end that Gladiator's activation.
Absolutely. We've got a Drake running, followed by an Incendiary run. He's got to get those guys out there and hopefully shoot some of those rounds up and over those Gatormen.
Got some great sportsmanship between these players already. They're laughing and joking with one another. It's really great to see that, you know, even at this top level of competition, these guys are having fun playing together.
Absolutely. And, I mean, you know, the pressure here is fairly intense, so the joking can certainly calm the nerves.
Sure. So we got 3 of those Incendiary are going to be in cover, which, you know, against the plethora of shooting that Rask has, will help them out a lot.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like Rasheth is activated. We've dropped Carnivore on the Titan Sentry. Going to make him extra hungry against those living models. And then what else do we have? Okay, so the Despoiler's going to get rushed from Rasheth. Get him out there ways. And then, Rasheth's last two Fury are going to go over to the Agonizer. And then he looks like he's just going to advance a bit. Well, under the mobility of his little Agonizer buddies. And then our sentry is ran forward. Right, and then that sentry was rushed.
Yes, he was.
And same with the Bronzeback, runs up under the rush power, a rush spell.
That's that mobility I was talking about. It's a 10-inch run from a Speed 4 model.
Yes. Now, I remember when I suddenly realized just how fast Scorn could be. It was a scary thing. And the Despoiler gets up there forward with a proxy base in between the Gladiator and the Bronzeback. And we'll get the Despoiler out of the way. Our second Bronzeback is going to run up 8 inches. No rush. So slow. And our Agonizer also speeds up. All right, so it looks like Josh is doing a little bit of color coding with his Fury points to keep track of what beasts they're on and what is and isn't on Rasheth. That's a good way to do it when some of those piles get up there. It can get a little confusing on what's where.
Yeah, so anybody sitting at home, it looks like the blue tokens are on the Agonizer. Anything that's white is on Dominar Rasheth himself. And I think those are red tokens.
Correct.
On the Warbeast.
It's hard to tell from here.
And so his turn is over.
All right.
So the minions are going to start their turn. Rask is activating first. And he's cast Fury on a unit of Gatorman Posse. And Admonition on himself to keep himself safe.
Yep.
And moving up towards that hill where he's probably going to try and keep himself as safe as possible while still utilizing his Trident Cannon to hopefully a lot of good use. Has a lot of great abilities. I think Rask is a great caster. First posse is going to Dirge of Mist and run, and that Dirge of Mist prayer is going to give them +1 defense and terror for the round, trying to keep himself safe from shooting attacks.
There are a whole lot of gators on that table.
Yes, sir. So those gators are going base to base. They are touching. It's a little hard to tell on the hill there, so that's been declared so that there's no way to draw line of sight through them for those three that moved initially. Ricard's taking a minute to think about his next move.
The paint job on Ricard's models is pretty impressive. We're getting comments from the judge that he's a little bit in awe of the quality on those models, which is always fantastic to see.
Pretty beautiful there. That spinner just went up to the hill, and it's been replaced with a proxy base because he was falling backwards.
He's going to have to look hard for some good targets.
Good to keep that pretty model safe.
Absolutely.
Yeah, from where he's standing, he doesn't look like he has a whole lot of targets, but I think he's going to do something here. No, it looks like he ran. So no way he would be able to make attacks there. Snapjaw has also run. He's been forced, so we see a Fury point going on to the Warbeast. First few turns are really important. You got to position yourself well to move your plan forward. So Wrong Eye is using the Submerge Animus and is advanced, keeping himself safe because if he gets shot off the table, Snapjaw's going to go with him, so he's going to keep himself safe as much as possible.
That's right.
Bull Snapper has run forward and put Spiny Growth on one of the posse.
Advanced forward.
Excuse me, yes. He did advance, not run. That is why he can do that.
And yeah, Josh just verified Spiny Growth. The Spiny Growth is model, not unit.
So that second Gitterman posse is activating. They've also used Dirge of Mist, and they are running.
So many gators on this table. It's amazing. Between the two armies.
It's a lot of medium bases, especially in Gatorman in particular. See a little, looks a little, almost like a little nervous tick from Rickard. He's playing with a token in his hand while he's thinking. I do that too.
I'm a big fidgeter.
Wrestler is riling. Looked like for one and then running for another one. So he has two Fury on him.
Counting up his Fury points to make sure that he's got the optimal amount out for next turn, I would imagine.
So the Witch Doctor has advanced and has zombified the center Gatorman posse. So that zombify is going to make them undead and give them tough.
And that's going to make that carnivore not as effective up there on the front line.
Third Gatorman posse unit activating. Uses Dirge of Mist and looks like they're running as well. So two of those posse have been declared as being toe into the forest. So that's going to give them another plus two defense for concealment. So those two in particular are going to be defense 15 against any ranged or magical attacks. So that's pretty hefty. Keep those couple guys safe. Bokur and Shamblers are running the unit on his left. The Bokur is completely in the trench, and several of those Shamblers are as well.
You got to watch out for those incendiary shots.
Absolutely. And he has passed the clock. Turn two.
All right. Josh is going to pull his Fury back to Rasheth. Back to full. Is he going to upkeep Carnivore?
Eight Fury is a lot of Fury.
Yep, and the Carnivore upkeep is free thanks to the Despoiler. That would be the Black Arts ability.
That extra one Fury is going to stretch a long way, especially with all those War Beasts.
No, absolutely. Checking his control area. Got to see what plans are going to be possible and what's not.
Rickard is hydrating. Very important.
What? Also, very dangerous to overhydrate during a tournament in which you can't leave your clock running.
He should be fine, though, because his entire army pretty much has Amphibious, so I would assume he does as well. So I think we just saw Rasheth checking his control area again. He's asking his opponent some questions. Just clarifying board state, making sure that he knows what everything is.
So verify that Rask is camping two Fury and that admonition is up. Who's admonition on?
Admonition is on Rask himself.
Okay, right.
Pretty scary question to get asked early in the game. Like, how many Fury are you sitting on?
It's right, 10-2. Like, what's your plan?
Well, I'm excited to see what he's thinking here.
We might see a little bit of that surprise scorn speed coming up here.
Could happen.
again, just examining board state. A lot of just important decisions to make early. Plenty of time left on the clock right now. So, you know, these moments don't put too much fear into the players right now. But, boy, those seconds tick away if the game goes long. And
If this turns into a real drudge, he might regret some of this thought later. But, you know, we just heard that he is commented on the positioning that Ricard has done, that it's very good, so it looks like he's not seeing that hole he's looking for. I know I don't see it, but...
No, I'm trying to figure out what I would do with all those Gators coming my way.
Cry?
Because from where I'm sitting, it seems like Ricard is going to get an alpha strike.
It certainly looks that way to me, but, you know, I don't know what they're going to pull out. You never know what they're going to do or how far they're going to hold back.
And, you know, you can always throw a little bait out there because the counter strike can be just as lethal.
Yeah.
So the Gladiator is advanced. He puts rush on the Titan Sentry. Speed and reach on a Titan Sentry, when you combine rush and reach, it can be pretty scary. It looks like the Taskmaster is going to advance. Let's see what he does here with these Gatormen. Tempered Flesh, so we're going to get Tough and Fearless, which Tough Gatormen are no joke.
So we got Tough Gatormen on both sides of the field now.
That's right. Well, that should just be an interesting battle.
Yeah.
But
it's like watching two hammers hit each other and rebuild themselves.
Once they're engaged, the Taskmaster can switch over to Pain Driver to give them +2 strength for one round and maybe give them a little bit of an edge. But again, it just depends on who hits first.
Yeah, and he'll cancel out that unyielding that both units are going to have once they're in the mess. They're both going to get +2 armor. So that could go a long way towards making the fight go to Reshef's side.
All right. Our sentry just trampled forward. And then, he's going to use his Locker Animus, which is going to All right, so the Rush Animus drops after the trample, or after the casting of the Locker Animus. And Locker is going to make any models that engage him, or I believe it might be just War Beast.
It's only War Beast, that Wrestler.
Yeah, if they get within his melee range, they have to advance only toward him.
Directly towards him, that's correct. So really shutting down a little bit of Ricard's ability to use the mobility to his advantage.
Okay. And Ricard just did a quick check on Rask's control area.
I don't know. I think that sentry might die next round. But we'll see. He's got a pretty high arm stat.
They're pretty tough. Arm 21 with that shield. Titans have some surprising staying power. Not so surprising staying power, actually, but there is definitely a lot of angry reptiles in front of him, so we'll see what happens. The spoiler follows him up. Let's see if we'll get some arcane suppression. Yep, that's we just got confirmation there. So after the despoilers advance, he used arcane suppression. That's while within 10 inches of this model, enemy models must pay double fury and focus points to cast or upkeep spell. It'll last for a round, and after the check, Rask is outside of that arcane suppression range.
Whew, I was about to say that would hurt Rask a lot with that fury 6, and all his spells cost 2 or 3, so that would have hurt him a lot. If he's careful and doesn't move too far forward, he should be okay, though.
Well, all right, so the Agonizer has come up, and looks like he's using Gnawing Pain. Affected enemy war beasts suffer -2 to their damage rolls, and the Agonizer's range on that ability is 5 inches, so it is going to envelop both of those heavy war beasts. And I think if he can get the other bronze back up there to have him split that frontal attack, and importantly keep that despoiler alive, Rask is only going to push back so far, so that the spoiler on the next round. you know, it's going to get up there. I think he's going to try to get Rask in that arcane suppression range.
And, you know, one thing we haven't even talked about yet is the possibility that Domino Rasheth might feed this round. And if he feeds, that's going to push that sentry up to an effective almost arm 25, I think. I'm not looking at the card right now, Ed, if you can remind me how that's going to affect things.
Well, no, Rasheth is living enemy models, minus 2 strength and minus 2 arm. So, yeah, that minus 2 strength is going to bump him up to a 23.
Sure, and then with the Agonizers already activated and done another minus 2, so he's almost an effective arm 25, which it doesn't work out that way because it's reductions to strength, etc., but effectively, that sentry might be okay.
That definitely presents a massive brick.
But we don't know if that's going to happen yet.
No, we don't. Looks like we are getting a run from the tough posse unit. And he's going to get up there and engage. And I believe he did check to see that shaman was engaged. The leader of the unit on the hill. Josh's clock is down, did I hear, 17 minutes so far?
17 minutes of his time has been used. That's correct.
There's still time left in this turn, too, because he's got a number of models to activate.
You know, I think he's taking his time now early on when he has the ability to, because once they're stuck in, your options get more limited. Your choices are more important, but...
Well, I also think he's gonna give Ricard quite a number of tough choices to make as well.
Oh, absolutely.
Which is going to make him take some time.
So we had a charge attack there.
Yep. Ooh, 5 off on the dice. That is a hell of a hit.
Yep, so 9 points to one hit, so he's dead.
One shot, and tough didn't work out there. And we have first blood. Josh is looking things over, checking out Rickard's force. What's he going to do next? These types of decision at this level of play would make me twitch.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Rickard right now, he's looking at the table right now, and you can almost see he is planning out his next turn already. Probably not too worried about losing that one Gatorman, but maybe a little bit of a moral loss there. That was a big roll.
Counting up some fury for Rasheth to see what he wants to do. He is checking the kill box measurement. To make sure that he gets Rasheth out of there.
That's a tough thing for Rasheth, because Rasheth's got that huge control area. He likes to sit in the back, so kill box is going to make him move forward maybe a little more than he really wants to. But
right. Well, with Josh deploying at 7 and then doing a full advance, he was at 11, and then he just pulled him forward another 4 inches and to make sure that he's out of the kill box. But, I mean,
Still pretty far back there.
He's still pretty far back there, right. It's a little scary because it's such a slow model. But you definitely called it there, Michael. We've got Rasheth's feet down, so he is going to reduce the strength and arm of models while they're in his control area. So if they move forward, it's going to, and they will, mm-hmm. It's going to take that strength and armor down.
So this is a breath of corruption that Rasheth has just channeled.
And who's he channeling through? One of his posse?
I believe it was through one of his Gideon posse. Waiting to hear what happens there. So this Breath of Corruption is going to do a POW 12 to anything that it hits.
And it's going to leave that AOE sitting there. Oh, he one-shotted the Gatorman posse leader there.
Ugh.
ugh is right. One shots on Gators, you know. A couple of those can be a little frustrating because they usually get in there and stay for a while. But there's still plenty left.
These rolls are on fire.
Yes, they are.
So we're...
But with this second roll...
So nine damage.
Nine damage. Another Gator goes down. Another seven damage to a Gator, leaving him with one box. Those were some pretty good rolls for a cost three Breath of Corruption, but that is one mean spell.
Absolutely. That spell does work against me every time I play against it. And, you know, using it well and placing it correctly, you can take out a lot.
Now, as a Crix player, I'm intimately familiar with it. And then, of course, we've got to roll the D3 damage on the posse that he channeled that spell through.
Absolutely.
Not quite as free as using an arc node.
But he's channeling through Gatorman Posse, who have 8 boxes. So
right.
See a little of that staying power you were just talking about.
Check the control area, see who's in it, and see how big that spread is so that when he advances his models forward, he can make sure that anybody that gets in there for that attack is going to suffer under Rasha's feet. He does drop another Fury on the Agonizer, which is going to move the Agonizer's ability out to 6 inches. -2 on damage rolls.
So it looks like he's got a War Beast up there on that objective looking to contest.
That's right, and it looks like he's going to use his spray attack on that defense 14 Gatorman, defense 14 there in the woods. Actually, with the spray attack. Is that posse going to be defense 14, or has he got something else going on there?
No, that was a miss. Okay. Definitely a miss.
I had thought I heard the judge say defense 14, but that's not the case.
Bronzeback runs.
Getting a lot of guys up there in that zone.
Yeah,
a lot of big heavy guys up there in that zone, which is so scary. It is literally a herd of titans.
Especially with that Agonizer ability out and Rashet's feet up, this next turn is going to be interesting to say the least.
The full frontal assault is. I would be wary of going that direction right now, no doubt. But at the same time, you've got to get in there because you can't let those titans keep coming through that zone.
Sure. The other option is going to be that Rask could possibly use his feet, which is going to, you know, shut down the Alpha Strike coming from Scorn.
Right.
But we'll see. Still the Scorn turn. A lot of options still. Yep. Very early in the game.
So our looks like our incendiary have advanced up and taken some shots, which has missed a Gatorman. Is going to deviate into our Gatorman unit leader over there. We've got a burning Gatorman over there.
Another shot going out.
He's got to hope this misses and deviates over that massive of Bog Trog Swamp Shamblers. He does miss, and it does deviate just right. All right, so the Bokur of that Shambler unit has caught on fire, as has the Gatorman Posse.
Looks like no damage, but that fire, we'll see what happens with that next turn.
Can definitely pop some of those Shamblers.
Got another shot going on another member of the posse. That's a 7, so a miss.
This turn is chewing up Josh's clock.
So that Gatorman is was defense 14 earlier because that is a hill, not a forest.
Seeing it wrong from the overhead. From the top shot, yeah, you. Thank you. I was. The patterning on those from above is identical, minus the trees, which frequently get removed. So,
sure. It's good to clarify this for the watchers at home just to make sure that everyone knows what's going on. There's a lot on the table here right now, so it's hard to keep track of it.
Let's also make it clear that the judge knows a whole hell of a lot more about what he's doing than I do.
Well, that may or may not be true.
I know Charles, and I am positive.
Yeah, well.
And then I know me.
Sure. So just for everyone at home, Charles Arrowsmith is our judge, and he's doing an excellent job here. He was actually the winner of last year's TempleCon Iron Gauntlet.
That's
final
right.
Round. So a little shout-out to Charles there.
It looks like the sentry has been caught on fire by a deviation.
Hopefully he'll be okay with his arm 21.
I think he'll be all right.
Got a long shot here. So that will automatically miss.
Okay, and he was aiming at that far gator in the back, actually. So
just looking for that lucky deviation.
So, yep.
Which he does not get.
So, looks like it just lands in the dirt.
Yep, looked like 6 inches straight back.
One more.
Another long
shot.
A
little worried about catching my... No, 1 inch straight forward. A little bit worried about my Drake getting deviated onto with those shots.
Yeah, that would not be a good thing.
And we've got the bronze back activating, and that is a run. Checking some of his cards there to perhaps clarify an option. Or midwinner is going to come up midfield. All right, so he's going to turn on no spells in his command range. So he's going to null magic. And that's not within his command range. That is within 12 inches of the model. So that is quite some coverage.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't necessarily think any spells would be coming from there, but better to be safe than sorry. Beast handlers are advancing.
Yep.
So they're going to...
Really just getting in position for the next turn.
And it looks like he conditioned the Gladiator to remove 2 points of Fury.
Get him up there.
Passes the turnover. We're looking at fire. Does not go out. Looks like no damage on the first one, I believe.
Oh, yeah, a little bit.
Oh, no, 1 point that would be.
And that was on the posse. Now for the...
Or 2 points? Sorry, 2 points on the first one.
Okay.
Looks like 4 on the second. That's a good roll. These dice are on fire.
All right, and so he has...
Fire goes out on one in the center of the table there. So that's got to be a relief. With the way that those dice are rolling. Don't want to lose another Gatorman. And we see him leeching his fury off of the Warbeasts to their controllers there. Kind of taking a quick look at the table, moving tokens, removing effects that go away. Just getting ready to take his turn to make sure that board state is clear. He has upkept Fury and is dropping ammunition off of himself. Oh, excuse me. He's upkept both, I've heard from the judge. Probably a wise choice.
When you said that, it was
I was wondering why, too, yeah.
Ricker's got a plan because...
All right. So Rickard's thinking, playing with those dice. I do that all the time. Asking questions, looking at... He has verified that Rashad's feet was used, so Rickard has that information now, so he can move forward with his plan, whatever that may be. You know, I talk about that scorn speed all the time, and they've moved really far up. A lot faster than you would think.
No, I mean,
initially.
They're
in there now.
You know, he's got Titans past the midpoint of the table. That's a stampede.
So the Gatorman Witch Doctor is advanced and used his zombify ability on the middle unit of Gatorman Posse up there on the hill. So once again, they'll have Undead and Tough. Snapjaw has advanced.
I'm going to go up against that Gatorman Posse.
I think we're going to see some swings here, at least I hope. We're checking the range on that feat. Ooh, double ones on that bite. Double fours on the tail, so that's a hit. Crit knockdown. Missing that bite. That hurts. So that's going to be 6 damage from the tail on that Gatorman. Buying a bite attack, an automatic hit, and failed tough check. Because the minimum damage there is going to be more than the health has. So that's one Gator down. Buying another bite, rolls a 3, which is a miss.
There's a hit.
No, I believe that was a miss. So that was 3 misses with 3 bites. That the one bite that did hit was an automatic hit from knockdown, so that's not something you want to see.
Another bite and another miss.
Man.
I just imagine they just ran up and said and hugged, right?
Well, I'm thinking that thinking wrong. I might be thinking about renaming Snapjaw to Lockjaw because that... Maybe he forgot to open his mouth.
I just think... checking the stats on the Agonizer.
Those Agonizers are beefy.
But there's something there if he can get rid of that Agonizer.
If he can get rid of that Agonizer, that does mitigate quite a bit. So we have...
He does hit the Agonizer. And he's boosting the damage.
7 damage. I missed what the attack was from.
That was from the spitter.
Oh, thank you. And that was not on the Agonizer. That was on a Gatorman Posse. So 7 points of damage there.
That Agonizer's way out of range.
Yes, it is. Sometimes it's hard to tell what's going on, but just keep it clear. And
well, that's also a combination of checking my notes, listening to the judge, and looking at the screen all at the same time. I've only got 2 eyes.
Right, me too.
I'll work on getting some more.
Sure. So it looks like... Gatorman Posse activating. And I think that's a charge. That's a charge order from that posse. So they're charging the incendiary eye. They have Bloodthirst, so they are charging against living models, so they're going to get plus 2 inches of movement. So that gives them a 10-inch charge range, and then they have reach with that Gatorman weapon. So that's a pretty big threat. Got one of them charging the Drake.
I guess we're going to get a second one charging that Drake as well.
Probably.
He certainly left that spot open. Yep.
Good call, Ed.
And
And his last gator, checking his options. I think he's going to go into that. Nope.
Going to move over toward that center objective and ensure that he's within the control command range of that shaman.
Yep, got to keep that command range intact. So, bite hits on
Incendiary.
Incendiary. Yep. So, 4 off, so 5 points of damage there. Pretty good roll. Hits with his second attack and kills him, so... Boxcars. But 1 point of damage to that incendiary. And second attack hits. Looks like that's going to be 2 more points of damage.
3 total. And Josh did swap out his incendiary unit leader.
Yep. That field promotion intact. So the charge on the Drake hits with the bite. Rerolling that cocked eye. So 4 damage to the 5 on that Drake. Oof. Last charge attack here, misses. That's a lot of misses on this turn for Rickard. He can't be feeling too good about that right now.
I think he's going to try and swap dice with Josh and see what happens. He's got a little more luck in those dice, maybe. Although I do have a tendency, I notice, is that my dice will go from hot to cold spells. So if they're cold now, we could see a turn of events that keep the averages there later in the game.
When they
suddenly catch on fire.
You can never count on dice. So Rickard is... Looks like he's charging with the Ganderman Posse. He's trying to get to that Agonizer, so he's using Proxy Base here.
And he did use the Cold Blood Prayer, which is going to let him reroll missed attack rolls against living models this
which
turn.
Which he's probably going to want to use after missing so many attacks. So we see you're pulling out a laser light to make sure that the angle is there and this is a legal charge.
That's right.
Like a free strike and a so that free strike from the Gatorman Posse on the Scorn side hit and did enough damage to kill that model and the tough check was failed. So that model only had 1 left, so not too surprising that he was killed. Get a field promotion there so that because of that line of sight, and looks like that charge is legal, and he is charging of the Agonizer. Getting ready to roll those dice. I'm getting anxious to see what he rolls here. Yeah. Not going to lie, at this point, I'm hoping for him that he at least hits. And last model in that unit, I think. It's kind of hard to tell with so many on the table, but I do believe this is the last one from that unit. It looks like maybe we'll be charging the sentry. Waiting for a declaration. Now, you know, he's charging the other Gatorman.
Might not want to cut through that Breath of Corruption.
Yeah, probably not. Not with the way that Josh is rolling today.
That's what I was thinking. Ooh, the bronze back counter charges.
So we see a proxy base going in there. And counter charge misses. So rolling hit on the Agonizer. Needs a 6, gets a 6.
Because this unit's zombified, it gets around the feet.
And one-shots that Agonizer, so that's a pretty big hit. And it looks like he takes that second attack on the sentry. And that second Gatorman was field promoted, so he's not able to make an attack this round. Some of the nuances of the game that are often easily forgotten is why we have our judges.
A rule I often ignore in the casual games. I wouldn't say so much as ignore as
forget.
Am ignorant of.
Sure. Got some more thinking going on. I don't blame him. There's a lot going on the table right now. And
Rickard always rotating those dice in his hand. Hopefully infusing them with a few more sixes.
Yeah. The will to land on the one with the six up. I wish I could get inside his head right now. I mean, I look at this table and I don't see all the options.
Even with the losing that agonizer, the debuff from Rash's Plague Wind is going to be tough.
Yeah, it's still definitely not going to be easy to take anything down. But you know, taking that agonizer out, that was a key hit. He's making his decisions wisely. The feat turn, you know, when your opponent feats, that's usually one of the turns where you're going to use a lot of time. At least that's what it was back when I would play in tournaments. I'd always remember, like, my opponent would feat, and then I would sit there and I would think for the longest time. But see, the players are having some fun here. Judge and Josh.
Yeah,
it
sounds like Josh's hope was that with that counter charge, he would kill that unit leader, causing a field promotion.
To keep that agonizer alive.
And allowing that other Gatorman not to make his attack on the agonizer.
So we've verified that the Wrassler can see the bronze back through that Breath of Corruption cloud, so I think we're going to maybe see a charge here. But again, waiting for confirmation from Rickard, making his decisions. This level of play, you know, you see a lot of thinking. It's really a thinking man's game. Like, you have so many options, there's so many things you can do, and if you make one wrong decision, that can cost you the game. War Machine is a game of millimeters and decisions.
And I think since we've mispronounced Rickard's name so many times, I'm going to start pronouncing Josh's name Josh, just to balance things out.
And that sounds slightly Swedish, so maybe we can make amends to the Swedish people. So got a little update here about times on the clock. Currently, at this moment, it looks like Josh has about 45 minutes left on his clock, and Rickard is sitting close to 53 minutes. So a little bit of a differential there. Rickard's got about 8 more minutes. I would assume he's going to eat up several of those during this turn, so I think they're going to end up about even at the end of this, but still plenty of time in this game. As long as they're very careful about their decision-making and make good choices, this game could still go on for quite some time.
Yeah, Rickard has more than 30 models to activate this turn still, so it's certainly going to balance out. But his decisions now are critical.
Yeah, he's either going to Gator done or he's not. Hey-o. I'm sorry to everyone watching at home. That was terrible.
And I'm shocked that we haven't had any NBA Jams quotes yet. I assume you're waiting for the final.
Yeah, saving that for the finals, Ed.
Very
good. Sure. So it looks like he's made some decisions here. So boundless charge on the Wrassler, and I think that was Fury as well. Rask has used his feet. So that feat is going to help a bit. Rask advances, toe on the hill. So Dark Waters is his feat. I'll explain it in a minute. It looks like he's taking a shot at the Void Spirit. He misses, needing a 7 to hit. Poltergeist moves Rest backwards, so maybe not a bad thing. So Dark Waters is going to make it so that Scorn Forces aren't going to be able to target with attacks or charges any models that are 5 inches away or more from his. So they're pretty close, so it's questionable how much that's going to help. Some of it's going to be real important here. Rasso takes a point to the 6 as it goes through that Breath of Corruption. And a reminder that proxy base right now is a Bronzeback Titan, so... So that's 11 points to the 2 on that Bronzeback. It's a solid hit. Pow 15 hit from second attack. Dice off 2. No damage with the fist. Second fist, no damage. Buying another bite. Nice big hit. So we got 4 to the 5 here. Buys a bite. Hits.
And he needs some of those high rolls for his damage rolls.
Yeah, I'd start using those green dice for damage if I was him.
And buys another bite. Another 10. And another average roll for damage.
Another 6 points to the 6. It's got one more attack here. Buying a bite. Spirit's out on that Bronzeback, so that's something. Hits with an 8. And 7 points to the 2. So we've seen him mark off those damage points, and
there he goes.
He does take down the Bronzeback. And the wrestler. And the wrestler uses his snacking, heals a point of damage, so walking through that Breath of Corruption ends up doing nothing in the end. Apparently Bronzeback does a body good. Confirmation that Rask did declare feat. Checking some lines of sight here. Wrong eye activates. Advances cast Spiny Growth on both Snapjaw and that Black Hide Wrestler, increasing their armor by 2, and if Warbeasts hit them, they're going to be taking some damage in return. And making sure that Wrong Eye's base is not underneath the Spinner's base, because that would be an illegal move. Pull Snapper advances. One thing you see, Shambler's running. These players take a lot of time to think and make their decisions. And then once they start actually making the moves and deciding what they're going to do, they move very quickly and with purpose. They know exactly what they're doing. And that's why they can afford to spend all that time thinking, because they know that once they have it in place, the precision they play with and the experience they have with placement and where they want to be, it's going to let things happen quickly. And it looks like he's jamming with those Shamblers, trying to get in the way of as much as he can. That die on the Boker is how many points of damage he's taken. And it looks like there's a Shambler in the zone.
So good.
Yes.
Won't still looks like points. There's some pretty good paths for that sentry to trample.
That's absolutely true. Although, yeah, and that would be a way to get around the feet. Not targeting anything if he's trampling, so... No.
Rickard's turn's not over, so... I guess I just expected them to be a little bit more spread out in front of him.
Rickard has a plan. I have faith. posse just ran forward. And it looks like there's a charge order there, so this is the charge roll here. Charge attack hits. Dice minus five gives us six
to that Gatorman.
6 points of damage to the Gatorman. Two more points of damage, which should force a tough check, which he passes. Another tough check here. Fails, so... Good night, Gator Man. Gator collapses a corpse. Boker runs. Pendrick is running now.
So we're having a little bit of technical difficulty on our end, guys. So we're having trouble actually seeing the game. We're able to listen in, but hopefully on your end everything is going well.
Yeah, we had a little bit of a monitor shutdown on our side, but we're working on fixing it as quickly as we can. Well, the players are pausing to check kill box. I hear from the judge. So it looks like we're talking about Rask here was poltergeisted back. No control points scared. And Rickard's got 44 minutes left on that clock. We've got our monitor back, so everything's returning to normal here. Sorry for that interruption. Hopefully you can forgive us.
And we're back over to Josh's turn three.
Yep, we're moving into Josh's turn three. So round three of the game.
He's pulling back his various spells and abilities. He's working on clarifying a few things.
Taking his time to think now, pulls the feat token off the table to let us know that Plague Wind is now over.
Carnivore has been upkept for free, so we've still got Carnivore on that Gladiator. Just a little discussion, trying to decide how to proceed. And it, to note with this shot that we're looking at here, the amount of activity going on around here is substantial. You've probably heard some of the announcements come through the mics from the other various tournaments that are running right now. So there is a lot going on. And it looks like Josh has activated the Void Spirit and charged one of the Gatormen from the posse on the far side of the table from our view.
Swinging a hit. It's a lot of dice.
Well, it's going to be five damage. So we've got three left on that that posse.
And the Void Spirit goes corporeal.
Right.
So someone might be taking a bite out of him next turn.
Yeah. Well, if they can kill a few living enemy warrior models near that despoiler, we'll pop some more void spirits out.
Some more questions happening. So verifying how many damage are on that model, checking the cards, making sure everything's correct. So the model that's currently the leader is at full health right now. Oh.
So many various tokens and tools out on this table to make this game happen.
Absolutely, though. So we're verifying what's within 5 inches because Rask did once again use his feat last turn, Dark Waters. Have an attack from a Gitterman Posse, 3 points of damage with that bite. Second attack. No damage.
We've got a charge that's hit for 5 points of damage.
Tough check.
And the tough check
makes
is
it
good. That's one lucky gator after surviving that bronze back charge and then the posse charge. And they're...
No tough check needed there.
Right.
Well, because they did not have tough.
Looks like we're gonna
check in some more melee ranges.
Is this an attack on Snapjaw?
Yeah, it was a miss.
Now we've got the Taskmaster moving up. And likely giving Temper Flesh. But I don't have confirmation on that. They're checking the clock.
Oh, it looks like the clock stopped at some point. So they're taking a pause in the action now to just kind of figure out what's going on with this.
Maybe it was somehow hooked to our monitor when we had that little shutdown.
Judge is making a call. Discussing how much time to take off the clock. Looks like they've decided on 5 minutes off of Josh's clock for his turn so far. Both players amicable to that decision. Again, seeing some great sportsmanship here.
Right.
So leaving 39 minutes on Josh's clock and 44 for Rickard. These are things that happen. Not ideal, but again, players are both amicable to the decision. Judge makes a call, and we move forward with the game.
There are so many moving parts in these tabletop games.
It happens.
That it's good to have a judge and some really great sportsmen.
Yeah, good attitudes all around here. So. Looks like some attacks here on Shamblers. Auto kills. I think this is the sentry.
Yeah, he's...
I didn't hear the declaration.
Cutting a big swath with that massive spear of his.
Continuing with these big rolls.
A halberd, rather.
Well, that's an average one. Still enough, though.
The sentry is now attacking the objective and does 1 point of damage to it.
That's 1 point closer to a scored control point.
And our score is presently 0-0.
That's correct. So people that don't know, these objectives do have 15 damage boxes. They are armor 18. At least the stockpile is. That's the one I'm looking at.
No, the Arcane Wonder is the same. Arm 18, damage 15.
I had a feeling they were. I just didn't want to say anything incorrect.
Josh has verified that the Gatorman up on the hill is knocked down because he passed a tough check.
So it looks like Rashethe is trying to channel a spell, and we're talking about how the feat works here. So since Rashethe is casting the spell, and he is more than 5 inches away from the model he is targeting, even though he is channeling through a model within 5 inches, the spell originates at Rashethe, so he is not able to declare that attack.
But
so it's not a legal declaration of attack, so no fury spent, no spell cast.
But Rashethe has activated.
Correct.
So he's got to continue with that activation.
Hopefully not too punishing. I don't know what Josh's plan is.
Rashethe is advanced forward just a little bit behind that bronze back, and Josh is counting some fury to make his decisions. Pulls three out. Still thinking.
Flip through those cards. That's a lot of rules to remember.
So we've got Carnivore on the Despoiler now, which is an interesting choice. He's also spent two fury to heal 2 points off the sentry. I'm not sure if the sentry had any of his aspects out or not.
I don't have the card in front of me, so I don't think he did, but it's still good to keep those beasts in tip-top shape.
He's also healed two off the Drake, so a lot of healing going on here.
Well, I think we see a lot of fury is going to be spent on these beasts, so Rashethe's just doesn't want to just dump the fury, might as well use it to heal up a little bit instead.
Well, absolutely, and that also lets your pain givers advance, and if you need healing, lets the pain givers do something else, right?
Sure.
Because there's certainly plenty that they can do. Looks like Josh is advancing midwinter or in midwinter.
Yep. 6 inches.
And what's Orin going to do here? Or has he already done his null magic? Yeah, it looks like midwinter. It is null magic, and we've got the incendiary advancing now. So he has taken away proxy base and put the incendiary model in on the other side of that wall.
not going to be able to target anything outside of five, so.
Nope. May as well move up and stab some things.
These cataphracts do love to stab things.
The Incendus Blades, reasonable. Powell plus strength 11. On a Mat 7 model, they are still...
probably going to hit.
They are still cataphracts, right?
BX cars. Dice minus 7.
So those were some big, those were some big rolls.
Yeah, that's another dead gator. Another hit.
And
4 points of damage.
Another 11 on the die roll.
I might try and buy these dice off Josh after this game.
I don't think they're going to be for sale if they take him all the way through to the victory lap.
That's true.
So the gladiators advance four and put his Rush Animus onto the bronze back there in front of Rasheth. Beast handlers are coming up now.
I think we might see some enrages.
And I'm not sure what Josh's little motion there was. So the despoiler is going to be is enraged when one beast handler has pulled fury off the gladiator.
I called that enrage.
Congratulations.
I am master of the obvious.
So it's like the despoiler is. Charge the Gatorman posse, not the objective, which I think is the reasonable thing to do.
I think so as well.
And with Carnivore, it's going to help cancel out that unyielding.
That's a 10 to hit.
And I didn't hear what the attack was made with.
Did do 6 points of damage to the gator.
That's right. Another claw.
Zero damage on that one.
The tail does hit. And that's going to be five off, which will cause a tough roll.
Goodbye. Which has failed.
Goodbye, Gatorman. Does that clear out the zone?
I can't see from this angle. But I'm sure the judges will let us know. It looks like there's still a Gatorman that's touched its toe in that zone.
Right, that shaman that keeps surviving all of the various attacks that Josh has thrown at it.
So we're moving the Drake there just to check.
Right, they explaining that to Rickard that the spoiler does have 360 and reach. So it's going to attack that Gatorman posse over there. Well, that's going to miss that 13 def. That one's going to hit, though. And that's a POW plus strength 14. And with Carnivore...
That posse has three boxes left right now, so
right.
That's going to be a kill.
Yep, that'll do it.
Not so many gators left on the table anymore.
And a void spirit. We get another void spirit from that guy, thanks to the despoiler's ability. And I think they're checking legal placement on that void spirit.
For sure. Everybody loves free void spirits.
Everybody that plays Scorn.
Good point.
So, Carnivore and the Despoiler's ability trigger at the exact same time. Josh is choosing which one is going to go first. And he's going to smash...
By a tail attack onto that objective, doing some damage. So now that objective's taken 10 points of damage total.
Yep, those numbers on the dice are counting damage taken.
So you're getting
and not remaining wounds. So that knockdown posse member is contesting the zone.
Yes.
That is what I believe I just heard from the judge.
I think that's what I heard from the judge, and I'm pretty sure he's in the zone there. Like,
so he is going to see if he can get in there to eliminate that thing.
It's really interesting to see the players fighting so hard for these control points, you know? Like, when I play Game of War Machine and I have this scenario, I always get big eyes and I want to kill a caster. So you see these players have a lot more discipline than I do. They're gonna play the smart game.
I've played a few of those games with you, and it's...
Yeah, every time I try and kill your caster, it never works out for me. I could learn a lot from these guys.
So the judge is confirming some facing after charging. All right, so that Void Spirit has charged, it sounds like.
Charged
the
posse,
yep.
But can't go past the objective. So he doesn't get that bonus die because he didn't move 3 inches. 6 damage to that posse, 2 damage left on him. If you're looking at those cards, nothing's looking very healthy right now.
No. Checking control. We've still got a gladiator over there. So the Drake is going to take a free strike, moving away from that posse member.
It's a hit. Oh.
Oh, that's a dice -3, so 9 points of damage there on that Drake.
Rickard's got to be pretty happy about that, taking the spirit out on the Drake.
Let's see what that does to Josh's plan. He's clearing some fury out of the way.
Getting really stuck into that zone.
I think he's... maybe thinking he was going to try to... I really don't know.
So we're talking about some rules interactions and when things trigger. This is why we have judges at these tables. They know all the rules and the interactions and the way that they work so that there are no disputes between the players. Charles is doing a great job. Getting a little update on the clock. Looks like Josh has 25 minutes left on his clock, and Rickard is sitting on 44. So quite a big differential there. But, you know, Josh is doing a lot of damage on this turn, so I don't think he's stressing the clock too much. The more you kill, the less time you need to kill more.
So we get the bronze back advancing and pass it over to Rickard. So the fire on the Bokur has gone out.
Gathering up all of his tokens from the previous turn. score is still 0 control points to 0 control points. So Fury is upkept on that Gatorman posse. No upkeep on Rask's admonition this time. A gutsy move, but I'm sure he has a plan.
So it looks like we've got two Fury on Rasheth.
I believe so. There's another two near the model, but I don't
think those
are on him.
He cast an Animus and healed a couple of his beasts, so I believe he spent six.
Sounds correct to me as well. You can hear some announcements for the hardcore tournament in the background that's going on here at TempleCon. A lot of great competition happening outside of the Iron Gauntlet. So Spinner is activating and advancing. So we are removing the proxy base from the table and replacing it with the model. Declares a shot, targeting Orin Midwinter. Boosting the hit. Three dice, needs a 9. That's a 9. He's going to risk it. There we go.
There he goes. The 5 wounds he needed to get him down there.
That feels good. He's going to boost the blast damage on the Taskmaster. Needs an 11. Leaves 1 box on the Taskmaster.
That was a...
Pretty good considering that Taskmaster is now corroded. So we're looking at a 1 in 3 chance that he does not die next turn.
Correct. There's a little confusion, but the Taskmaster is still there with a single point of damage on him. Josh making sure that his cards are accurately marked because he had wiped all damage off of it, thinking that Taskmaster was dead.
Like you do. Shambo's advancing. Looks like a combined melee attack. Hits with a 10. Pow 10. Leaving 1 box on that corporeal void spirit. Some more attacks happening here.
The judge is actually asking what happened there, so. Like he is going to move. Snap. No, that's a proxy base for what? There we go. It's a proxy base for Snapjaw. They changed out a 40 mil base for a
50 mil.
50 mil.
That's why there was some confusion.
Yep.
Snapjaw advances. We're verifying defense on the Gatorman posse, which is defense 13 at present. Declaring a bite attack. Hits with an 8. Needed a 7 there. It's a pow 17 hit, so hoping for some damage. Dice minus one. Boosting to be safe. Here comes the rail. Yep, that's enough.
No tough check roll. Fails.
We're got players trying to figure out which posse are injured, figuring out exactly how many boxes are left on which models.
Yeah, help Rickard make smart choices on his targets.
Verifying where that damage came from, fixing cards.
We had a...
Oh, another box card. Seen a lot of those this game. So that would have been a crit knockdown, but that Taskmaster
has... preventing the knockdown on that posse member. However,
damage roll six
damage
six
there. And we'll tough force check. A tough check, and he... And no knockdown from the Taskmaster when making that tough roll. So he's got some staying power.
Yep, definitely seeing some of that synergy.
And yeah, he was the wounded one from arcing that spell through him.
Boosted the hit roll.
Pal 17 kills that
Void Spirit.
That last box on that Void Spirit. We'll give you long periods of silence, after which we will talk over one another.
Like we do.
Like we do. So, looks like Snapjaw's done doing his thing.
Rickard's asking some more questions, just verifying board state. Getting tokens out of the way. And Gatorman looks like he's charging
up on that,
Arcane Wonder.
Arcane Wonder, yeah.
This is a charge order to this unit of posse.
Yep. Now, when he hits this model with a melee attack, it's going to cause a Plasma Nimbus. But I don't think that the posse is too worried about the attacking model suffering a PAL 10 electricity damage roll.
Probably not.
Although with Josh's dice, once again.
That's true.
It can inflict some pain. So. He has... also charged and trying to get just within melee of one of Josh's posse members.
So we have a Gatorman charging a Gatorman with not enough movement to get a charge bonus there. Auto hit on the objective here, dice minus five. So 9 points of damage. It's a mighty Casey is at bat.
Pretty substantial.
Reach attack on the Taskmaster, and PAL 13 is enough. Takes him down. A little wild dice, but hits the Gatorman posse. There's some rolls. Tough check. Fails. So that posse member is removed.
No, I did not see the... the Plasma Nimbus trigger on that objective, on that Arcane Wonder.
So I've got an update on the other game happening during this gauntlet round while some thoughts are being made. So in case anyone's wondering at home, currently David Kander is sitting at 2 control points with 3 minutes left on his clock. Jason Watt with 0 control points, 24 minutes left on his clock. So we'll have to see how that one pans out. Back to this game. Wrong Eye is checking his control area. Rickard's checking on the Spoiler's defense, which is consequentially a 14.
Right. Oh. Base is 11. I was like looking through my notes to see where that was coming from.
Correction from the judge. Defense 11. Some snake eyes on that first damage roll. Double fours on the second. So 3 damage to that Gatorman finishes him off. Poker collects a
corpse token.
Corpse token. And that's the poker from the Swamp Shamblers unit directly behind those Gatorman posse.
Right, the far unit.
Gatorman Witch Doctor advances and zombifies that posse at the bottom of your screen.
Always fidgeting with those dice.
You do the same thing.
Absolutely. I don't have a mustache to twirl.
It's true.
I should get one of those. While the thinking goes on, it's a beautiful day here in freezing Warwick, Rhode Island. Mike and I can see the snow coming down outside the window onto the many
snow that is on the ground
we've already got. It's nice to be in here with
not
where it's warm and the action is keeping things warmer. That was weird.
It was. Bet those Gatormen are glad they're inside that cold blood. They'd be hurting. Again, I apologize. Swamp Horde's advancing. Putting elasticity on the wrestler, which will give his attacks reach. And that is going to be on all of his melee weapons. So that's his claw attacks and his bites.
I just want to see him stretching that snout out, because I'm thinking he's going to, well, I don't know, Bronzeback or Sentry. It looks like
we'll find out.
With reach. Both.
Possibly. Rickard is not activating that wrestler yet, though. Still thinking. What's he got going on here? Activating the Booker and Swamp Shamblers, receiving a charge order. Pulling out that movement widget to check for 3 inches. And we see Josh standing up to confirm whether or not the charge bonus will be given. First Shambler gets the 3 inches. Second charges but does not get 3 inches, so will not get that boosted attack roll. Third one charges will receive the boost. We got one more. Shambler's running. And the Boker is also charging into that sentry. I think we might see him utilizing that death magic this turn for some extra attacks or some boosts. Or both. Attack roll and a hit. No damage on that dice minus 11. Another attack and no damage. Boker misses because of set defense. Second attack misses. He's going to death magic to buy an attack. Hits.
The sentry has been hit by that attack.
Another death magic to boost the attack, the damage roll on this. No damage.
Those sentries are a tough nut to crack.
That's correct.
And I believe that's all the Swamp Shamblers from that unit.
I think so. There's still one sitting there that he left to be in the way of that Bronzeback.
Oh, right, the one that ran around the
yep.
the outside. So the wrestler has moved down, and he has got reach on the sentry.
Makes an attack. Nice damage roll. 10 damage.
Wow.
Wow. 4 off on that seven one. Still more. Another 7 to the 4. Wow, Ed, when you were talking earlier about dice turning around,
that's
I think
right.
we're seeing that right now.
Well, on that wrestler, I mean, he's already killed a bronze back. This is the sentry next. This is six more to the 3.
Wrestler kills another beast.
Josh commenting on Rickard's dice rolling.
Yeah.
I don't think he's been paying attention to his own dice to know that he's was doing the same thing. But, man, that wrestler has got to go. I mean, seeing it now from here, the Swamp Shambler came around yep. blocking the counter charge from the bronze back.
And that that wrestler has no damage on him, so didn't get to use his snacking, but... Titan is still what's for dinner. Update on that other game. David Chandler has clocked himself, so Jason Watt will be moving to the finals.
So we're going to have a Scorn on.
Something game.
Minions or Scorn at this point. The dual Scorn matchup could be a really scary one.
Or we could see the Scorn on Minions again. We'll have to find out what happens here. Checking control area for Wrong Eye. Considering his options carefully. Wrong Eye is charging the wrestler. So he is casting Voodoo Doll on the bronze back. Needs any. There it is. That's a 12. That hits. Yep. So he had an extra die in that roll from Pendrake. So handy hit. So that Bronzeback's not going to be able to use his spirit next round. That's going to hurt.
Absolutely.
That beast lore from Pendrake can do a lot of good. And Wrong Eye misses the wrestler.
How convenient.
WrestleMania.
Ouch.
So, no spirit on that bronze back. 2 other Titans down already. Got some more attack rolls happening here.
Another void spirit out.
Void spirit takes him out. Those gators. Got 2 misses on incendiary from those gator mans. Posse misses the spoiler.
And it looks like Rickard's clock is down to 21.
I think that's
or
a 23.
So just a minute less than Josh.
Josh has got 24. So they're pretty even right now on time. Got some very distinct measuring going on there. Checking everything really carefully. Making sure there's melee ranges in place. The Drake is engaged by the posse because the posse's reach of 2 inches.
Might be that Swamp Shambler that's engaging him, actually.
Could be.
I don't see a Gatorman. Well, maybe there is one there.
Rask advances, toe on the hill. Checking line of sight on, I think it's the bronze back. We'll see when he declares. Yeah, he's checking range to that bronze back. So with that Trident cannon, he's got 3 shot types that he could choose to use. If he's thinking about shooting his Trident cannon, he could be casting a spell.
And if he has line of sight, don't forget we've got that Ironback Spitter in there as that proxy base.
That is correct. He actually wouldn't be casting a spell, though, because he doesn't have an offensive spell. So he does not have line of sight.
So he had only moved 3 inches. He moves back. And he passes time over to Josh.
Turn ended. So we're moving here into round 4. Score still 0-0.
And right now, Rickard does have 21 minutes to Josh's 24. And the clock is ticking. And yeah, as it passes, there's still no control points have been scored.
You know, for a minute there, I really thought Josh was going to get a couple. I didn't think Rickard was going to be able to contest that zone, but, you know, these are some great players here. They really know what to do with their positioning and their models, and things are going well. And we see them sharing a laugh. Love seeing that.
And it sounds like Rasheth had to cut for 3. And Carnivore's up kept for 3. Thank you to Spoiler.
The Spoiler says you're welcome. Let's see. Checking some half inch.
So the Drake is now activating, checking the Drake is engaged.
And free strike from the Gatorman posse. Oh, 12 points of damage to the 1. Ouch. That is a dead Drake. Boker gets his corpse.
Hot dice from Rickard.
You know, early on I said this was going to be an uphill battle with all that armor, but it's been pretty good.
Yeah, honestly, right now I would just have a vendetta on that black-eyed wrestler. I was like,
yeah, I'd probably get big eyes and try and kill it, and it would lose me the game. But
time for your comeuppance. Well, I mean, right now it looks like it's contesting the zone. Sorry, yes, the wrestler is actually the proxy base.
Proxy base, not the spitter.
Said earlier that it was the spitter, but yeah, that's the wrestler. I'm like, wait, didn't I just say that was the spitter? And yeah, I would be tempted to just try and pound that thing out of spite.
Sure.
But I'm a spiteful man.
Yes, you are.
Nobody else on this channel to jump to my defense, I guess.
More so, thinking.
Yeah, you know, more thinking, more when, talking back and forth.
When you have a plan that involves your Drake and then your Drake disappears, kind of have to reassess.
Incendiary are activating. they're going to
take some shots.
Snake eyes for a miss on a shot, it sounds like. Or he needed anything but snake eyes to hit, rather. Like, I didn't see any dice roll.
Kills the shambler, corpse to the boker.
Boker's on fire.
Boker's on fire. All right, so no corpse, my bad.
Yep, and yeah, no damage on the boker from the blast.
But on fire.
Try and clear that other shambler. Yeah, he's going to go for that wrestler. And the bronze back doesn't burn from the fire. And there he goes, bronze
shot.
Back. Oh, taking a shot up at
the wrestler.
Wrong eye.
Oh, wrong eye.
Oh, he. He did hit the wrestler.
Hit the wrestler,
on the hill,
but also tags wrong eye with right. The fire. Oh, BX cards again.
Wrong eye takes a point of damage from that blast. Josh checks his options.
I mean, that bronze back still has no spirit.
And
so the bronze back's not going to do a lot this turn.
That is correct. I imagine Jason Watt is now watching intently on the remainder of this game because one of these two guys is going to be his opponent.
Probably so. Looks like Josh has made some decisions. And activating. Looks like his beast handles are activating currently.
Gotcha. He's got those guys spread out, but keep that leader right in the middle and
they'll be okay.
They are quite effective. Sure that they're all within the command range. All right, we've got an actual melee attack with the lash, and he hits.
No damage, but anatomical precision
That's
makes
right.
it a one.
The gladiator has been enraged, as has the bronze back.
I mean, I can't tell how far it is, but I mean, I guess you could rush that bronze back. You could probably walk up and get a couple swings in.
That's right. Did he also enrage the despoiler?
Don't believe so.
He put a token on him, but I'm not sure.
I did not hear what that was. Guess we'll have to wait until the spoiler activates to find out. Oh, the suspense.
All right, well, here comes that despoiler activation. So the despoiler is charging the posse.
Got a clock update for you. 16 minutes for Josh's clock. Rickard's sitting on 21, so still plenty of time left in this game.
We're sitting the despoiler at reverse facing so that he can get his positioning correct. So he can reach the boker, is still within melee of the objective.
Yep.
And has hit. Ooh. No damage. He's only done 1 point of damage to that posse member in two attacks. There you go.
Wow.
And a reversal of die rolling. That Boker goes away. He's Boker's RFP'd and becomes a void spirit. He's now attacking the Gatorman. 4 points. And there's three left on that guy. He's going to hit him again. Ooh, dice minus three, no damage.
No damage.
Oh. They're talking about how Carnivore isn't being a huge help right now. I believe those guys are undead right now.
Yep.
And the tough roll
feels tough.
Finally fails. And that Gatorman is gone.
See what he does next here. Going to buy an attack on the objective. See if he can't score a point, maybe. Two off.
And there it goes.
So that's going to be
a control point for
control
Josh.
Point at the end of the turn. You know, I think thinking about what he's doing here, by enraging that bronze back, the bronze back's going to have to charge, but without being forced, so his spirit being gone isn't going to matter. So that's going to be a big hit from that bronze back.
Right.
Wasn't remembering my interactions of the pain givers, so that's making a little more sense to me now. Smart move from Josh.
And Josh is down to 13 minutes on the clock.
Checking line of sight to Rask. And seeing that Rask has a single transfer.
Well, the Void Spirit has charged Rask. With his toe on the hill.
Rolls a 5 to hit. So that's a miss.
Checking his control. And reading a couple of spells. So we're going to channel Breath of Corruption through that Beast Handler. He did hit the Gator up on the hill, which is going to do, I think, 5 damage.
5 points. Kills the Gatorman leader.
So that shaman will
that was not a Breath of Corruption, it was a Sunder Spirit.
Judge asking why the template AoE wasn't going down. So, yes, Rasheth is going to put